Okay. If you talk to judges today about why civil jury trials are vanishing, they say it's the fault of the lawyers. The defense lawyers, they say, don't know how to try a jury case. They're afraid of trying a jury case, so they don't want to go to trial. And they say that the plaintiff's bar just is anxious to put their third of any recovery in their bank accounts. So they want a mediation to force a settlement that avoids a trial. Talk to the trial lawyers, particularly the plaintiff's bar, and they blame the judiciary for erecting so many obstacles to getting to trial, like enhanced pleading and liberal summary judgment and all these gatekeeping doctrines that are designed to keep a large corporation from having to confront a jury in a civil case. They say it just takes, it's too difficult to get to trial. If you talk to the defense bar, they say they advise their clients to use mandatory arbitration clauses, and if not arbitration, at least to settle before they have to go to a jury trial, because cases take too long, they're too unpredictable if you go before a jury, and you got to do it all in public. Our next panel is going to present you with the view from the bench, the plaintiff's bar, and the boardroom. I once had the privilege of trying a patent infringement case before Judge Young in Boston. The way he organized the trial, the way he treated the jurors and explained the law to them, not from behind the bench, but wearing a lapel mic and roaming the courtroom as any great trial lawyer would roam the courtroom, led me to believe that judges have ample power, if they will only use it, to transform the jury trial from an entertainment event to a learning experience. And that, in turn, led me to the first goal of the Civil Jury Project, which is to assemble a group of federal and state court judges who will try new things in their courtrooms as laboratory courts to see whether they improve comprehension and improve the result. And if they do, then we'll go out and proselytize their brethren to do the same, to try those same things. Of course, my chief cheerleader for this effort on the bench is Judge Young. Joining him is Professor Arthur Miller, an esteemed member of the New York NYU School of Law faculty and the nation's foremost expert on federal procedure. Like me, he remembers a golden age of the trial bar, when courtrooms were busy with jury trials and judges respected jury verdicts. He has written extensively recently about how and why things changed in the mid-80s. Our final panelist is Robert Gasaway, a Washington, D.C. partner of Kirkland Ellis, who advises general counsel and corporate boards and executives about when to hold them and when to fold them. He is here to explain to us why these executives and their general counsel are happy to opt for a bench trial, or better yet, no trial, and rather a confidential, non-public arbitration. So let's begin with Judge Young.
Steve, thank you so very much. The faintest print in the program here, I want you to look at it. It says a view from the bench. That's what this is. This is not the view from the bench. These are only my views. They will resonate with some of you and not with others. Also, they call this panel Who's to Blame. I'm not going to blame anyone. I'm going to confess. Now, let's talk with utter frankness. The greatest contribution of American jurisprudence in the history of the world is our judicial independence and our American jury trial system. That's what we've created. Yes, came from Great Britain, but we use it for more different, theoretically, because Professor Lerner is right, for more different problems in more different circumstances than any society has ever done. 90% of the jury trials on the planet take place in the United States of America. Now, against that background, and I'm going to talk about this vanishing jury trial. It's a complex phenomenon, and I'll try to be brief. But I'm only going to focus on the judicial branch, the judges, a piece of it that perhaps I know something about. I've been a judge for 38 years. When I came on the bench, the senior active justice of the state court where I started said this. This is a trial court. Trial judges go on the bench every day and try cases. Fast forward 38 years. There's a brilliant article by my good friend, Brock Hornby, The Business of the United States District Courts. It's in Greenbag. I commend it to you. He says this, trials are not coming back. Trials are like telephone landlines, useful in some circumstances, but not the principal means of dispute resolution. Except for the trials not coming back, he's absolutely right in his description. So what happened? What happened in his 38 years? I suggest to you the following happened, and it's not that people are ignorant. It's not that people are less than professional. The federal judiciary today is as professional and hardworking and devoted and independent as ever it's been. This is not some old guy's reflection on some golden age that's past. But the truth is, what we have done is we have almost utterly deconstructed the role of the trial judge and replaced it with the judge as administrator of dispute resolution. If vital as this conference is, think about this question. In one of the emails that Steve sent around, he said he was going to ask this question of me, and he touched it. He said, why are judges afraid of jury trials? Well, we're not afraid of jury trials. We love jury trials. And most judges, remember, you don't have to be brilliant to try a jury trial. You laugh at that. I stand before juries and I explain an evidentiary ruling. I say, now look, this isn't rocket science. This is a communitarian effort. Lawyers, judges, jurors, litigants and witnesses reaching out for justice and coming as close, I submit to you, as any effort of that humankind has ever intended. It's a different skill set to be an administrator of dispute resolution. If we are administrators of dispute resolution, it means we're supposed to know something about the various forms of dispute resolution, and indeed we do. And I suggest to you that when I start ranting on like this, people say, well, this old judge, he's against management. That's wrong. No good trial judge can be against management. But management to what? Management to what end? I submit to you the goal of the entire process. Well, I'll quote to you from Owen Panner, a great friend. He said, Bill, there isn't too much to this judging business. You find out what cases you have. You get them to trial as fast as reasonably you can. You decide those things you need to decide. You try the case the best you know how, and you keep moving on. And you know he's right. The goal is to get the parties to trial, not to force them to trial. Oh, I'm for settlement. I dance a jig when a case settles. It can be the most interesting, fascinating antitrust case, and I'll go try the slip and fall on a fish boat, because those people want the trial. If for other reasons, the parties settle, but settlements should be fair in light of a trial. Another thing Brock said, Brock, it's such a pleasure to cite you. People, litigants, real people don't want trials, jury trials or other kind of trials. What they want is the reasonable expectation of a prompt and a fair trial. That's what brings them to settlement. That's what we should be doing. Now, the American jury system is dying. It's dying faster in the federal courts, my court, during my watch, than it is in the state courts. It's dying faster on the civil side than it is on the criminal. But it's dying. And already it has been so marginalized that in our polity, the founders would not recognize it. Oh, they would recognize. One of the things I'm fond of saying, because I'm from Boston and John Adams actually was a fine trial lawyer in our city, and I have signed the same book as a member of our bar that 2 centuries before John Adams signed, because all the lawyers do sign on our bar. And you know, if John Adams went into the Suffolk Superior Court today, where I was proud to start my service, he would know exactly what was going on. And yes, Professor Lerner, you're right. The fact that John Adams would understand it all doesn't make it right. All right, I recognize that. But you see, we are in the millennium, another century. And what's different today is that while our theory is jurors have this broad right, the practice is contrary. We need not have trials for the sake of having trials. That's crazy. What we need to do, what we judges need to do, is be skilled. The crown jewel of the operation is to provide a trial. So, let me advance with some real humility. 3 things I think we need to do. If the jury system is to survive, 3 things are necessary. First, on the civil side, we need a robust, constitutional, vigorous understanding of the Seventh Amendment. Don't think simply because we have a Seventh Amendment that our understandings of the Seventh Amendment are the same. Professor Lerner, and I thought she was brilliant, but I'm with Professor Amar, show you the range. I submit to you we should think there are 6 types of constitutional officers in our government, only 6. This is Professor Amar, but this is what I say to juries every time I welcome them. The legislature gets 2, senators and representatives. The executive gets 2, president and vice president. And the judiciary gets 2, judges and jurors. And when I welcome the jurors, I tell them that they are here potentially to become constitutional officers, because when they decide in those cases that go to juries, the facts of those cases, they are performing a constitutional function that neither I nor the United States Attorney or President or Senator or Representative can do. Only the people of the United States can do that, civil or criminal, in an appropriate case. So I suggest to you that we should think of rights that we frequently think of as the litigants' rights, as the jurors' rights. And here are four, very quickly. Everyone has an equal shot to sit on the nation's juries. Everyone, if you're a citizen. Second, you cannot be discriminated against by race, gender, or ethnic origin. Third, the jury has a constitutional right accurately to be instructed as to the law. Their right is accurately to be instructed as to the law. And on that right rests the judicial independence of every court below the Supreme Court of the United States. That's why it is vested in an individual district judge to declare an act of Congress unconstitutional. We're not elected. I've never run for office. I did it only once and got reversed, but I was later vindicated in Blakely versus United States. But be that as it may, all right? Look, the only reason down in the lower courts we have what I call first instance constitutional interpretation, the only reason is because we have a jury system. That's the only reason. The jury system won't work without that. We can't certify every interesting constitutional issue up to the Supreme Court of the United States and wait for the answer. We've got to tell these people, as Marshall said, Chief Justice Marshall, what the law is. Fourth, on those cases at common law which a jury has a right to decide, that is a juror right. We don't call it a demand for a jury trial for nothing. Who are they demanding when the parties demand that? They're demanding it of the institution. They're demanding it of the judges. They say, oh, we want this decided by a jury. And this business of us being the experts on dispute resolution has led we judges into what I suggest is some unconstitutional terrain. Mandatory ADR? Oh, I'm all for voluntary ADR, voluntary mediation. Well, once a case is ready for trial, and it's a jury case, the jurors have a right to decide it. This came home to us, I know, at least in the epiphany for me, was when Congress shut down the government in 2013. And we all got asking ourselves, who are essential employees? And we decided, you know, hey, even though we can't pay them, we still have to have jury trials. And the reason for that is civil and criminal. Because if Congress, through the appropriation power, could extinguish a right to a jury trial by not paying the juries, then it's hard for me to imagine a more obvious violation of the separation of powers. This is serious business we're talking about. Second point, and I'll end, second and third point, but I only take a minute on the third. Second point is this. As one who labors in the vineyard here, I am so proud to be invited to this and so fascinated by these studies and innovations and the things we might try to make it better. I'm hostile to peremptories too. Lawyers know that. All right? Now, but I'm also here to tell you, and I mean this with all respect, in the big picture, none of that makes any difference. Folks, none of it makes any systemic difference because we've priced ourselves out of the market. Our courts are too slow, vastly too slow, and we are vastly too expensive. And you know, society doesn't sit still. I imagine Mr. Gasaway will talk about that. You know, they can get their disputes resolved. People have to have dispute resolved. They come to court. They ask for a trial. Sometimes we say, well, no, you know, you really should settle this. You don't really deserve a trial. We have no business saying that. I'm not saying that we don't advise settlement. We should. So that we must focus like a laser, we judges, on doing what we know how to do best. And that is try cases. If we focus, as I was originally, this is a trial court. Trial judges go on the bench every day and try cases. That doesn't mean we don't manage. Doesn't mean we're against mediation. We are for all those things. But those are part of the process that leads to trial. All the other things will take care of themselves. I believe that passionately and believe I can support it with statistics. And third, we need this project. I beg of you, this is the last best hope of the civil jury system in the United States of America. This project. Now, I'm not saying it's got to be rigorously academic. If the best it can do is document the demise of the civil jury, that's a goal. It cannot be an apologist for the jury. I try that. But the project can't do that. It's got to carefully, rigorously analyze it. But what it can do, and what today it is doing so well, is floating these issues before the nation's, I'm not one of them, I'm just a spear-carrying judge, but before the nation's leading, thoughtful scholars and experts on these subjects in a forum where people will make a difference. This project is vital. I've overstayed my welcome. I end, and I mean this absolutely with how I end. I'm the jury liaison in our court, and each Monday I go out to greet them and tell them much what I've told you, toned down a little bit. But, well, you people. I won't say you're special, you're not jurors, but this is how I end, or this is how the speech ends, but I'll end this way. Every single jury trial is both a test and a celebration of the right of a free people to govern themselves. Go now and do justice.
Professor Miller.
I miss hanging around with that man. Yeah, really.
He got me tipped over one of the first times I was reversed as a judge, but I've loved him ever since.
But I made it clear to the First Circuit you had only made two errors. Like the judge, I have to make it clear, I'm not an empiricist, I count nothing. This is a personal view. It's a personal view, just as the judge offered his as a personal view. I dissent from him when he says he doesn't blame anybody. I blame everybody. That may reflect the ethnic difference between the two of us, I'm not sure. Now, as some of you know, I'm a proceduralist. You know, I'm a narrow-minded, rules kind of guy. I've been at it about 60 years. But my life started to go downhill in 1986. That was the year that the Supreme Court decided three summary judgment cases. They breathed life into the summary judgment procedure. They said it's not a disfavored procedure. Now, what has that got to do with today and our subject? The answer in my mind is that it started two phenomena accompanied by a frame of mental approach. The two phenomena, number one, early termination of litigation. The second phenomenon, front-loading of the procedural system. The mentality that those three cases projected, every judge had to make a decision on a summary judgment motion as to the plausibility of the case. Plausibility. It's a word I have grown to hate. And if I had the power, it would be stricken from every dictionary. That's an invitation to the judge to balance things. The summary judgment motion is supposed to be about law. It's supposed to be about law. Whether there is a legal basis to move to this trial. But now plausibility begins to blur the line between the pure issues of law, like has the statute of limitations run, to questions of fact, reasonableness, substantiality, materiality. And I can't prove this. I just feel it. That judges began to cross the line between those two categories in the context of the summary judgment motion. Obviously, any motion that's granted prevents a trial. And if it prevents a trial, you never get to the issue, should we impanel a jury? You have taken it off the boards. Well, you can guess what I'm going to say next. That if that wasn't enough, in 2007 and 2009, as my life was going further down the tubes, Supreme Court decides the Twombly and then the Iqbal cases. And once again, that hateful word, plausibility, gets projected. This time, in the context of a motion to dismiss. The clock is moving backward on adjudication. In 86, the focal point is summary judgment. In 07 and 09, the focal point is the complaint. Nothing more, just the complaint. And judges are invited by the Supreme Court to determine the plausibility of the case. How, your worships? You don't have to go to sleep. You're supposed to use your judicial experience, your 38 years. And you're supposed to use your common sense. I do not pass judgment on your common sense.
You understand, Arthur, I work for these people.
Yes, but you're not. You don't have to be, or I don't have to be responsive to them. Listen to that. Judicial experience and common sense. That's subjectivity. That may depend on whether you went to PS 225 or Andover, Harvard or Brooklyn College. Once again, the line between the pure issue of law, which for centuries has been what the motion to dismiss, its precursor, the demurra, its postcursor, the 12B6 motion, pure issue of law. Is there something legally cognizable here? Is now merged into a concept of plausibility. I can't prove it, but I have a feeling that in many of the post-Twombly-Iqbal cases, the line has been crossed. And cases ejected from the system, which of course once again means they never get to trial. And once again, the issue of jury trial becomes irrelevant. What I am suggesting at the wholesale level is that our procedural system from 86 on, with this movement toward early termination and front-loading, is simply preventing cases from reaching trial in quantities never before seen before. Let me add to that gatekeeping, Steve referred to it, and judicial management. The judge referred to that. As a former reporter of the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, as one of the people who wrote the manual on complex litigation, I confess I am guilty. Judicial management, we thought, in writing the manual and then in amending Federal Rule 16, we thought it was the greatest thing since animal crackers. And in some respects it is, but the mentality of gatekeeping and judicial management is, of course, a perfect illustration of bases for early termination, and much more significantly, in my judgment, front-loading. The whole system has moved its balance point from trial through summary judgment back to gatekeeping, judicial management, and the 12B6 motion. I won't speak for Mr. Gasaway, but who doesn't make a 12B6 motion these days? Who doesn't fight Daubert? I'm watching a case now that's in its fourth month of Daubert hearings. Maybe one reason they don't get to trial is they all die of fatigue. I don't know. And again, with forgiveness, this is the defense bar's paradise, given the fact that you work on an hourly basis. And the plaintiff's bar is working on a contingent fee. So we know that economics is having a lot to do with this. Now, final point, as my whole life is passing in front of me. Sort of the stake in the heart. The stake in the heart is Concepcion and American Express. Arbitration. we are now replacing trials, judges, juries with arbitrators. And they're doing it one by one. The whole judicial process of open discovery, evidence, cross-examination, jury of your peers in open court with transparency is being replaced by a private adjudicatory system. The public system is being replaced by a private system. And it's being done under a presumption of arbitrability without regard to how adhesive the contract with the arbitration clause is, with no respect for state law or any even blink of the eye toward the economic realities of proceeding one by one by one by one. All in the context of settlement. All in the context of, if you're a plaintiff's lawyer, facing a procedural construct that is so forbidding, so elaborated, so costly, so time consumptive, that you've got to think settlement. You've got to think settlement. You've got to think workout. In that environment, nobody goes to trial. In that environment, we can save a lot of money on jury fees. The constitutional construct is being replaced by basically a private adjudicatory system coupled with a procedural structure that is absolutely forbidding. So, it's with great sadness that I reach my senility. I am overjoyed that there are people like Judge Young out there fighting the good fight. But we fool ourselves if we think he is a consensus. I remember where I was when Pearl Harbor was bombed. I remember where I was when FDR died. I remember exactly what I was doing when Kennedy was assassinated. And of course, I was in this building on the fourth floor watching Twin Towers collapse. You know what else I remember graphically? When one of his colleagues said to me, if any case on my docket reaches trial, I have failed. I think it's time to cash it in.
Superb. Just superb. Just superb.
It's amazing the difference that 6 years makes. I'm not ready to cash it in yet. And I think there's things we can do to solve the problem. But I want to put this to our next speaker, who is supposed to give us the view from the boardroom. Professor Miller talked about all these doctrines as the cause of the demise of the trial. And I definitely agree with that. But my question for the next speaker is, would we ever have these doctrines? The gatekeeper doctrines, enhanced pleading, liberal summary judgment, mandatory arbitration. Will we ever have these doctrines, Robert? were it not for the fact that the business community persuaded the judiciary, beginning with the federal judiciary, in a campaign that began with Ronald Reagan in the beginning of the 80s, that there was something wrong with trials, that juries were not to be trusted, and that it was not fair to make a big company go up before 12 citizens drawn from the community. And therefore, all of the doctrines that Arthur talks about were the product of this public relations campaign to instill fear in judges about what the unfairness of juries. So that's your question to answer.
Who's Patty?
Well,
she's good.
Thank you, Steve, and thank you, Professor Miller. It's great to be back here among so many friends at NYU. I want to start out and give the view of give the view of corporations. I'm going to start with the standard view, the standard wisdom. I'm going to go into the deeper wisdom, and then I'm going to say something that may be surprising. And let's start with the standard wisdom so we all get on the same page, and that is the issue we're talking about here is dispute resolution. Dispute resolution is a service. It's about the economics, stupid. It's all about price and quantity. If we can bring the price down, if we can bring the quality up, you will get more of it. It's simple economics. It's supply and demand. And from the corporate boardroom, it's too expensive, and it's too unreliable. Quality is too low. Cost is too high. Why is that? It's discovery. What's the advantage of arbitration? Less discovery. Bias. You're not going to get a biased arbitrator. You are, at times, going to get the lynch mob jury. You are, at times, going to get a plaintiff lawyer that's egging them on. Complexity. We talked about expert witnesses. Let's talk about both liability complexity and let's talk about damages complexity. Liability complexity, the types of cases that we see, whether they're securities cases, they're corporate tort cases, they're personal injury cases, they're class action cases, very complex facts, multiple witnesses. And now let's talk about the complexity of damages. We heard a little bit about pick a number. One corporate general counsel said to me, that is one of the major problems with juries. I don't know if you could go to the workman's compensation model, but think about that. Pick a number. The problem is those jurors have very little conception about the difference between $10,000, between $1 million, between $10 million, between $10 billion. Pick a number. Now, how do they pick a number? Well, that plaintiff lawyer says, Corporation X had $50 billion of revenue, and they had $5 billion of profits, and all I'm asking for is X. But what they don't realize is Corporation X is operating absolutely as efficiently as it can because it's trying to supply products and services to the market in competition with competitors. It's trying to operate absolutely as efficiently as it can because it has to compete for investors in the marketplace. So the fact that it has X billion dollars in profits doesn't mean it has this huge margin of error. Now, that's the standard wisdom. That's true. That's one problem. Now, the deeper problem, the deeper wisdom. In, I think it was 2002, I wrote a law review article that I commend to all of you. It was in the Harvard Journal of Law and Public Policy. It was very short, few footnotes, very concise, the problem of tort reform. And what I think happened is that our current legal system, our current adjudicative system, is an unintended byproduct of some of the most important and some of the most favorable constitutional law developments that we've seen over the last 25 years. What am I talking about? Due process, harder to discipline lawyers, commercial speech, more lawyer advertising, solicitation. It arose out of solicitation of lawyers by the NAACP in the civil rights area. So what you have is what I call the entrepreneurial lawyer. And why is the entrepreneurial lawyer a problem? It's because the runaway verdict
is much more problematic now than it ever was before in history. Why? Because the runaway verdict isn't confined to a single case. It's not just over and done with. Remember the view from the corporate boardroom. Remember the view of the general counsel. What is he? First, he's a general manager of specific litigation, okay? So in a case that Steve Susman is involved in, or Arthur Miller is involved in, or I'm involved in, there's a player coach and there's a general manager. The player coach is us, and there's a general manager up there. He's talking about which experts we should hire, which strategic moves we should make, those sorts of things. Now that's the top of the iceberg, but he's also a portfolio manager. He has a whole portfolio of litigation out there that he's trying to manage. So at the same time he's playing general manager about these cases that are above the waterline, there's a whole portfolio of other cases that are out there below the waterline that he's thinking about. And what else is he? He's a risk manager. He's thinking not only about the cases that Steve Susman is trying or that Arthur Miller is appealing, he's not thinking not only about the other cases that are in the door, but he's thinking about the potential cases that may come in the door. And so what happens when you have that runaway verdict? Well, two things happen. Number one, it's public. It's not private like an arbitration. But number two, because you have this unintended litigation system revolving around the entrepreneurial lawyer, again, epiphenomenal from cases like Gold v. B. Kelly or our Virginia Board of Pharmacists in the commercial speech area, or the NAACP in the client solicitation area. Nobody designed it. But when that runaway verdict happens, what happens? The cost of the portfolio goes up, the portfolio litigation goes up, and the risk management. There's new cases that come flooding in the door because of the economic incentives. So-and-so just got rich, they got a third of this enormous jury verdict. Maybe I can get some. Or at the very least, there's a headline in the Wall Street Journal or the New York Times saying XYZ Corporation gets rung up for big bucks, corporate wrongdoing, punitive damages, et cetera. And people say, okay, there's a target. That anti-corporate bias that we worry about is even more palpable in that particular area. So remember, the fallacy of just the dispute resolution model is in the world of the entrepreneurial lawyer, we're not looking at a fixed quantum of disputes that need resolving. We're looking at a dynamic flow of results. And because of that, that runaway verdict, when the wisdom of crowds does not operate, that runaway verdict has a multiplier effect. And that corporate board or general counsel is looking at that verdict not just as, boy, you know, the player coach did a really bad job in that game. He's looking at it as a portfolio manager for his other cases, and he's looking at it as a risk manager. And now just one more point to close. I do have a lot of sympathy with the goals of this conference. You know, Steve, I thank you for inviting me here. I thank you for including me in this wonderful conference and this wonderful panel. Professor Amar said something profound when he made the reference to Lincoln offhand. Lincoln won the Lincoln-Douglas debates because he was a trial lawyer. While Stephen Douglas was wasting away in the United States Senate in Washington, Lincoln was trying cases on the 8th District of Central Illinois. And if you read those debates and you see how he conveys complex factual material, walking them through the history of slavery, if you see how he avoids attributing motive to Douglas or any class of people, and if you read the Peoria speech, and this is particularly apt before lunchtime, where he says, Douglas has talked for 3 hours, you must be hungry, let's break for dinner and go, and oh, by the way, Douglas has a rebuttal when you come back, so you Democrats, you come back, and of course, he's preparing his closing and his rebuttal. The culture of the trial lawyer is being lost with the culture of the trial judge. There is a different culture between a managerial judge who embraces ADR and a judge who embraces trials. Those are two different types. And just in the time that I've been practicing, and I've only been a lawyer for 22 years here, so I don't have the stripes, but there has been a cultural change, and I wonder if the cultural change has been bigger in those 22 years than it was from John Adams to Abraham Lincoln, and from Abraham Lincoln to more senior and distinguished members of the bar like Steve and Professor Miller. If we lose the trial culture because of entrepreneurial lawyering, my view, or because of bad Supreme Court decisions and some others' view, we are losing something precious in our legal culture, and I leave you with that thought.
Great. And because we have a few minutes left, six to be exactly, I get to ask some questions. Robert.
Yes, sir.
The rumor is that arbitration is supposed to be less expensive than a jury trial, but Judge Young wrote an opinion this summer in the Nexium case that he said it costs $30,000 a day for a jury trial. I don't know where he got those figures, I'll ask him. But certainly if you have a panel of three arbitrators paid by the hour, you are paying them at least $10,000 each for a day of their time. You are paying at least $30,000 only for the judges in arbitration. Given the other things you hear about arbitration, that judges paid by the hour, for example, never grant preliminary motions to dispose of cases as a matter of law. They want to get the collect the hourly billings. That judges, private judges, paid by the hour are not going to encourage the parties to settle. That they are going to require extensive post-arbitration briefing. That the result of hiring a judge who wants to be hired in another case is a tendency of that judge to split the baby. There are no clear victories. That's why it's more predictable. It's easy to divide what the plaintiff asked for and the defendant asked for by two, and you get somewhere in the middle. So do you know of any companies or general counsel that have now decided, you know, I don't want arbitration clauses in my contracts. I want to go to trial. Judge? Go ahead.
Well, I it would be unfair to identify it, but yes, one of the things I was so struck by Mr. Gasaway and his comments on culture are so spot on. One of the things I've tried to do is go out to these associations of general counsel and the like. If you're a trial judge and you're at all active at the bar in a perfectly ethical way, you'll know a lot of trial lawyers, and a lot of trial lawyers want to talk to you. You don't talk to the general counsel that much, and it's very good to talk to them. So I did this once, and because I'm not going to identify anyone, that was our deal. One of the things that they taught me was the following. They believe we're impartial, the trial courts are impartial, state and federal. They don't like arbitration as among each other, the bet the ranch intra-corporate. Oh, they love consumer arbitration because it takes care of the consumer. But by and large, they prefer the courts except for London Rules International Arbitration, which at least the group I was talking to, they said was the best dispute resolution system that was out there. And if I could just, I can do this in 30 seconds. His comment about culture I want to emphasize, and that's true in the trial courts too, and I'll tell you how every lawyer can spot it immediately. If you go before an administrator of dispute resolution for any type of conference, and you come away, one lawyer will say to the other, he's wondering how to get rid of our case. Same conference, same case, but you go before a trial judge, and you come out, one lawyer says to the other, she's wondering what the verdict slip's gonna look like. They are different skill sets. Overlapping, but different.
Well, I would agree with Judge Young on sort of the breakdown of the procedural preferences. Again, the the problem, and you know, he said it here. Think about the public runaway verdict, right? So it's a bet the company case. We tried to merge with, you know, Professor Young Incorporated, and the merger wasn't consummated, and therefore there's a whole lot of litigation about who defrauded who in the negotiations, or there's a Pennzoil issue about whether there was a contract or not a contract, right? So that does not have the multiplier effect. That, you know, that's a dispute resolution situation, and then people are going to look at that and say, A, that's material. I want to get that resolved justly. B, I want to get it resolved quickly, and C, how I can do that. It's much different, obviously, in the consumer context, because when it's in the mass consumer context, if I defrauded customer A about the billing of his cell phone contract or the McDonald's coffee cup or what have you, that's where the multiplier effect comes in, right? However much that coffee cup customer got in that one case, that is obviously not uppermost in the mind, and I don't represent McDonald's, but that's not uppermost in the mind of McDonald's. If it's that coffee cup, why not other coffee cups? Why not other problems? And you're setting a new standard of liability that's going to bring people out of the woods. So I think what you have to do when you think about reforms, and let me say, I've heard a lot of interesting ideas that I'd like to think about here, but I think you have to decide when the multiplier effect is really driving corporate decision making and really driving some of these doctrines, and when it really is one-off dispute resolution.
Professor Miller?
Two quick points. I'm amused, Robert, about your image of the runaway jury projection and multiplier. Who has greater access to the media, the defense bar and corporate America, or the scattered collection of plaintiff's lawyers out there? The truth is, you guys project McDonald's in the media by trying to convince the American people, see what a horror show American litigation is? I'd say that's a self-inflicted wound, and you can't get benefit on both sides. On the culture point, and I think this is important, the generation of people becoming judges over time are imbued with the culture they practiced in, which is a settlement, early disposition, management, motion culture. So maybe the worst thing about this, Judge, is that it's perpetuating itself.
Well, I would say it need not, and of course, that's why we're here.
Well, let me just say, what you hear from the judge is the litigator culture. I don't know if you were a litigator beforehand, but that passion for justice, it's the last best hope of mankind. You know, we heard Abraham Lincoln. We heard Martin Luther King, right? You know, judges and jurors and parties and witnesses and bailiffs and clerks, we're all in this together. You know, that is not a management judge. I could listen to him for the first 5 minutes, and you know what you're dealing with. Somebody else, you know, it's a completely different culture. It is a completely different culture, and if you don't think judges replicate themselves, or if bar members are attuned to the culture of the judges and adapt to it, obviously I think you're wrong. And if the jury trials is a dying breed, I think the culture that Judge Young represents is, I don't know if it's a dying breed, but it may be a diminishing breed.
You know, I've got to say this. I agree with everything you said, with one exception. I am a management judge managing for trial. The best I did was 18 months without a down day, save for speaking, taking vacations, and other events. But every day I was in court, I had a trial. That's what I'm going for, and I will put the amount of settlement, the percentage of settlements, fair settlements, it seems to me, up against anyone with the focus on the goal toward going to trial. I don't think you meant that kind of a judge.
I know what you mean. I agree completely.
But I'm a management judge for trial.
I agree with him.
One final question to all panelists.
If you look at the 30 years, if you take 1986 or 85 as the year things began to change, Arthur said he knew where he was at that time. If you take that as the turning point, you look at the 30 years before and the 30 years since 1985. In my experience, cases, jury trials have not gotten more expensive. They have not gotten more complex. Juries have not gotten less trustworthy. It's about the same. So what happened to change this perception about whether juries can be trusted? And if it was something other than those things, expense, trusting them, the comprehension, if it was in fact some PR campaign just to say, well, all litigation's bad, period. It's all bad, and judges should get rid of this poison as quickly as possible. If that's really what happened in 85, can we do anything about it? Are all of our, what this project's about is to think about improving jury trials? Maybe it's too late. Maybe what we ought to be doing is going out there raising millions of dollars to put on some PR campaign to restore the public's faith in trials and juries. Not, we're going to improve jury comprehension. How about that, Judge?
It's a democracy. It's the free marketplace of ideas. It truly is. Studies, and now I'm going back to your studies, and boy, I'm a fan of the 12-person jury because it involves more people. Jurors with remarkable regularity come away from the experience inspired, committed to it, and again, studies show that wholly outside the litigation system, with 12-person juries and jurors who served on criminal trials, they are far more likely to take part in the life of their community. So in essence, you're saying was how you spent your life worthwhile. I'm biased. I think it was.
All right, that concludes this panel. Thank you very much for being with us.